one word, you calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes are open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Just one word, you hear what's broken inside. Just one word, and you revive every dream. Just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes are open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can do. There's nothing that our God can do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can do. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I'm ready to rise. Let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise. Let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise. Let all agree. There's no power like His power. There's nothing that our God can do. There's not a mountain that He can move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise. Let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus.
I don't want to be afraid every time I face the waves. I don't want to be afraid. I don't want to be afraid. I don't want to fear the storm just because I hear it roar. I don't want to fear the storm. I don't want to fear the storm. Peace be still. Say the word and I will set my feet upon the sea till I'm dancing in the deep. Peace be still, you are here, so it is well. Even when my eyes can't see, I will trust the voice that speaks. I'm not gonna be afraid, 'cause these waves are only waves. I'm not gonna be afraid. I'm not gonna be afraid. I'm not gonna fear the storm. You are greater than its roar. I'm not gonna fear the storm. I'm not gonna fear it all. Peace, peace, still. Say the word and I will set my feet upon the sea till I'm dancing in the deep. Peace, peace, still. You are here, so it is well. Even when my eyes can't see, I will trust the voice that speaks. Let faith rise up, O heart, believe. Let faith rise up in me. Let faith rise up, O heart, believe. Let faith rise up in me.
You may be seated. Thank you so much. You did it with one hand?
I had a hip.
If you have your Bibles today, we're going to be in Mark chapter 4, verses 35 through 41. So let me give you a little bit of history about myself, because as I continue just to tell you folks things about my past and the ridicule that I take for the life that I lived. So I would like to say that I was a sheltered child, but in actuality, I wasn't. I just didn't pay attention. So I was born in 1983, and I know some of you are looking, going, the pastor's not supposed to lie. I'm well aware that I look like I'm 45 or 50 years old. I'm well aware of this. I am only 38. I know. Those of you young folks in here, this is what happens. You just wake up one day, and all of a sudden, people thought you were 25, and now, poof, this is what happens. Was also skinnier at 28, too, but this person ate that person, apparently. So in 1984, and this is how unaware that I still am of this, there was this big flood that happened in the Roanoke Valley area, which is where I'm from originally. And that storm, I've only ever heard one story about this storm that apparently devastated Botetourt County in Roanoke, was my dad was a police officer, and another police officer had to bring my sister home from school, and my dad met him at a bridge where there was water, and they walked back across. It still doesn't register this as a big deal. We had an ice storm. Apparently in my life, a few hurricanes took place and came through that area, and it just never occurred to me. So I get married, we have children, we decide we're going to move. We move to the great state of Alabama. So when we move to Alabama, as we're unpacking and doing all of those things, one church member came over and just looked at us and said, "Hey, we're so glad you're here. Hey, just remember, weather radio's 108. And I'm like, "Great. What's a weather radio?" Because I was still in that. I was 29, so I wasn't old yet. I was still 29. I was hanging on to it. I was still in that mentality that only people over the age of 50 watched the weather. You know, did anybody else have that experience with your parent? Those of you that have apps that pull the weather up and you've never lived this experience, my parents would watch the news, and if you came, it was like, "Dad, shh, the weather's on." Okay. You sit down because you might miss that it's going to rain. Or if it snows. I will say at my house, if they were calling for snow, all cars were locked. Chains, not chains like for your tires to drive, chains so the car couldn't move were put on it. We were not allowed to leave the house if it may flurry. So I asked, "What's a weather radio?" And she, the lady responded back to me. She goes, "You know, so if there's a tornado." And that's when it hit me. This state has tornadoes. So I began to ask questions about tornadoes, like, "How much warning do you have?" "Well, you know, a bit." I'm like, "Oh, hold on, I don't quite speak Southern yet. I don't know what a bit means. Is a bit 5 minutes? Is a bit an hour?" "Well, so, you know, the sirens will go off." "There are sirens?" "Yeah, you see that telephone pole there? You see those things on top of it? They're sirens." "What do they sound like?" "Well, they go off every Wednesday just to test them." "We have to test these things?" So I'm in a panic because I have just realized I have moved my family that I love and I care for to a place that has swirling funnels of death that can drop on you in any minute. And then they go, so I said, "Well, what happens if the weather radio that I don't know what it is or own goes off?" And they said, "You go to your safe space." Great. What's a safe space? It is not what we would define a safe space as today. But a safe space is supposed to be in the basement. We didn't have a basement. So then they said, "Go to a room without windows." Every room had a window. So then they said, "You go to the bathroom and you get in the tub You lay a mattress on top of you. And I couldn't figure out why we needed the mattress. Like, it was just so foreign to me. We're a family of five. I was not this big, but I was not a little fella. There are not many bathtubs that will hold me alone. And now we are talking about a bathtub to hold five people. Even though one was a little bitty baby. And the conversation didn't get any better. And they said, well, and in the event of a tornado, usually it's not the tornado that's so bad, it's all the looters. I'm like, looters? So we go and get a weather radio. And as I'm setting this thing up, it has a setting and it says, when do you want to know? And I'm like, as soon as possible. Because it was like the first week we lived in this house. And I'm a morning person. When I wake up, I'm up. I don't go back to sleep. I can get up at 5 a.m. and I'm awake. But I am not a wake you out of a deep sleep person. So when I am asleep and all of a sudden you hear, meh, 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 meh. And then the weather radio comes, oh, tornado warning. I don't know what a warning is. And we're screaming, get to our safe place. We don't know. There's lights on the first time that happened, we didn't sleep all night. We were up it felt like 15 minutes. You know, you're walking outside, just go outside and I'm looking. I don't see a funneling tube of death. And go back in this house. We then later found out that if you set your weather radio to sensitive, it will literally go off whenever they're calling for rain. After living in Alabama for a while, we'd start hearing sirens and people are screaming, go to your safe space. And everybody's like, we got one more inning in this ball game. We can finish this bad boy. I mean, you got guys on a lake fishing. That catfish is right here. We're catching this bad boy before the tornado. I talked to buddies of mine, and they were like, yeah, that last tornado, I was sitting in my deer stand. I'm like, you're a bigger man than I am. But even though that we thought, we listen to those storms, and we think about how devastating they can be, because a tornado can absolutely devastate and demolish an area. Actually, where we lived the year before was when that huge tornado in Alabama that was 2 miles in diameter had ripped through the state of Alabama, and it stopped 2 or 3 miles away from where our church was. So seeing the path of a tornado and the destruction makes those storms just very real to me. And we never lived through an actual tornado. The closest we ever came was there was one night where there was whatever the we're beyond a warning or what. I still don't understand our system, warning, watches, advisories. Just we had to go shelter, and we had moved into a different house, and we had steps, and the safest place for us to be was in the little, what I call Harry Potter's room, where you open the door and you're under the steps. There is a name for that. I don't know it. And you can tell me after the service, and I won't know it next time I talk about it. But I remember us, we had just mats laying out, and we're laying in there. And well, the kids were laying down, and Megan, for the most part, was standing up, and I was near the door hoping that we didn't all die. But just imagining being hurtled in and just thinking in that time, if something happens, what happens to my family? What happens if this tornado hits this house? What happens if the stories you hear about, you know, getting separated in this storm? And, you know, while that's an actual physical storm, and we think about those things, we also run into these other storms in our lives, these things that hit us from out of the blue, which is the craziest thing about a tornado. You know, there are people that talk the difference in tornado and hurricane, and everybody that says, oh, I'd rather live in a tornado area than a hurricane. No, I want preparation time. When I can pull boards out and board up and we see it coming, I'm better with that. I like to plan. You're cutting grass, and the next thing you know, run for the hills. But really, it's those that just happen all of a sudden that we're unprepared for. And you know, this is one of the more famous stories in the Bible. This story is in three of the four Gospels. Everybody but John writes about this story. And it's Jesus being on the water in a boat with the disciples and being woken. So we're going to pick up here. Again, Mark 4, verse 35 through 41. It says, "On that day, when evening had come, he said to them, 'Let us go across to the other side.' And leaving the crowd, they took him with him in a boat, just as he was, and the other boats were with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat, so that the boat was already filling. But he was in the stern, asleep on a cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, 'Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?' He awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, 'Peace, be still.' When the wind ceased, and there was a great calm, he said to them, 'Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith?' And when they were filled with great fear and said to one another, 'Who then is this that even the wind and the seas obey him?'" Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we are so thankful that we can come here to look at your word. Lord, to see how we can combat storms of life. Lord, ask right now that you bind the enemy from this place. Fill it with your presence. May it be your word spoken, not mine. Help to draw us closer to you today. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen. So paint this picture, if you will, of a calm ocean. I know we got people in here that like to go to the lake. And you see just that calm water that looks like glass. And then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, you have this storm. I'm not a big boat fan either. You guys are learning a lot about me today. I can get on a boat, but I'm a firm believer in boats have weight limits. Hello. So I was on a pontoon boat once at this pastor's conference, and it was the safe pontoon boat. My wife was pregnant. My buddy Jonathan, who wasn't my buddy at the time, but after this story, we became real good friends. My buddy Jonathan, who was another pastor, his wife was pregnant, and we were on Smith Mountain Lake. Relatively safe lake, I've been told. And we were told, hey, this is the safe boat. They also put the president of the convention that we were at on that boat as well, because it was a safe boat. So when a pontoon boat fills up with water, and like by the time it hit our knees, the men on the boat go, "At what point do we get the life vests out of this trunk?" And the boat captain goes, I kid you not, he was just in a daze. And then the boat came back up, and he goes, "Oh yeah, pontoon boats don't sink. Pontoon boats don't sink." It's a boat, right? If it stops floating, it sinks! And you were trying to get water on this boat. I don't even remember how the water got on the boat, but there was a little door kind of on the edge of the pontoon boat, and when it opened, Jonathan slammed it shut because that was going to do something. We all thought that was a great reaction, but if you've ever been on a pontoon boat, there's a hole under it and over it. It did nothing. But it looked awesome. But when you hit just that storm, when danger starts coming, when water starts piling in, we need to realize one of the most important things that we can in this story, where Jesus is on this boat. And one of the things, while we know that Jesus rebukes the disciples, I think sometimes we don't give the disciples credit for one very important thing. They knew that Jesus could save them. They knew in this moment of terror that Jesus could fix this problem. And I think it's important for us that we should realize that only Jesus can truly calm the storms in our lives. You know, we're going to be faced with so many different storms as life goes on. None of us will live a perfect life that never deals with any trauma, deals with anything that just, I've never met that person where it's like, I've never had any sort of conflict ever. Everything has just been perfect. We're all going to deal with something. Maybe it's losing your job. Maybe it's even like a long-time illness that you see. You know, there's different storms that we're going to face. We're going to see some coming from a mile away. But then there's those that just happen as well. And we need to recognize that no matter what kind of storm we face, Jesus is the only one that can calm it. Now, we as humans, I do think we tend to be like the disciples, because I'm imagining this boat with the waves tossing. And so my family and I, we've started watching DVDs again, and not that that's a bad thing, but we had gotten into the focus of everything we did was streaming online, but we got some spotty service sometimes, so now we pulled out DVDs and watched them. So we went through this Pirates of the Caribbean kind of marathon, because there's 10,000 of them. And one of the things that just fascinated me is, I don't think that when boat people are yelling out words that the words mean anything. And when you watch this movie, they're screaming things like grab the masses, grab this torque line, grab that rope, and they're just yelling things. And these people are going and grabbing. And I feel like while these boats are taking on water, there's a Peter in the boat screaming, trim the sails. I don't know what that means, but they say it all the time when there are storms. There's somebody screaming, grab that line. They're doing everything they can to keep these boats from sinking. And they hit this point where the boat has water and they just go, we can't do it. Wake up, Jesus. And I also find it interesting. It says Jesus was asleep on a cushion. So walk through what we know about Jesus for a second. Like the fact that the disciples decided it was so bad they had to wake up Jesus. Because Jesus is also says at other places, the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Jesus doesn't have a home. He's not going to his house to lay in the bed and have that nice cushy mattress, or you know, the pillow that we all love. You know, you've got your pillow, and if somebody takes your pillow, you get upset. But Jesus has found a cushion to lay on, to get some sleep. And we are going to get him off of this cushion. I mean, I'm just thinking, trying to be one of the disciples in that moment, to know he's comfortable, the boat is rocking, and he is asleep. And they wake him up, because they know that he's the only one that can calm this storm. You see, we have to give our faith and trust to Jesus. But where the disciples probably did everything in their power to work through this on their own, they should have gone to Jesus first. Really, what Jesus tells them is, if you have faith in me, you know that I'm here. You know that I'm taking care of this. Yeah, these waves seem big. Yeah, this storm seems bad. But I'm in your boat. This storm is nothing. It means nothing. If you know me and have a relationship with me, this storm is meaningless. You know, we have to learn to not rely on ourselves, but to trust in the Lord, to give him these issues when they come up. I'm not saying that we stand back and just do nothing and throw our hands up and say, you know, I'm not doing anything. But we are to seek God and to seek his direction, because his ways are better than our ways. We follow him through this storm. Because if he is sailing the boat, if he's on the ship, we will get to the other side. Most of us in this room could probably admit it's when we try to do things on our own that it gets messy. But when we follow God, when we go to him through prayer, through building that relationship through Bible study, the storms are so much smoother. It's so much easier to get through. The second thing that we should recognize is we should recognize when Jesus works in our life. And I think we make a mistake a lot of times of wanting to get through these storms, and we pray, and then God gets us through, and it's like, ha, look what I did. And we forget very quickly that we did nothing and that God did everything. And we're to recognize what he's done. And I think we see that at the end when the disciples say, who is this that has the power over the wind, over the sea, over nature? I think it's also important for us to understand the power of God's word. I mean, this is an example where Jesus says stop and the winds and the storm stops. But let's not forget the other things that Jesus did with his voice and that God did simply with his voice. God the Father created everything with the exception of man by speaking it into existence. The heavens, the earth, the water, the animals, the trees, the grass. God spoke it all into existence. God speaks demons out of people. He tells them to go and they leave. He simply tells people that this person will be healed and they're healed. Yes, we see examples where he lays hands on people, where he puts mud on their eyes, but there are other instances where he says, you're healed, and it's done. Think of the paralytic man whose friends lower him down and he says, get up, go. He does it with his voice. He calls Lazarus out of the grave with his voice. A man who's been dead, who's been dead for several days, who's in the tomb, and he says, Lazarus, come out. With his voice, he called that spirit back into the body and for the body to get up and walk. There is so much power in his word that I think we often forget that. One of the things that I think, too, in this story, because we all have these kind of as kids, we learned how this story went. There have been movie and TV adaptations of the storm, and you hear Jesus get up and go, peace be still. And then it just slowly calms. And it's just this picture. And we watch this movie and we go, oh. He said in a very Jesus-y, calm voice, peace be still. And the waves settled. And the storm started to move away. But that's not what Scripture says. That's not what this story actually says. It actually says that he rebuked the wind and the sea. So we have a dog. We have lots of dogs. But we have one dog that we spent a lot of time training. And at one point in her life, I would have brought Dynasty in here, and we would have shown you what her obedience training's like. However, she's getting older and stubborn and doesn't listen as well. It's kind of like she's a teenager now. But anyway. And then we have an older dog who, man, this dog's got 3 feet in a grave and one on a banana peel. Like my wife tells everybody, ain't nothing on this dog work except his teeth. And DeSoto and Dynasty, like, probably the new most famous phrase at my house is, Shane, get your dog. Because anybody can walk outside and say, Dynasty, boom, she'll be by your side. She's supposed to come around and sit on your left side. She doesn't do that as much since she lost her right eye, but that's what she's supposed to do. We got the poodle. I don't know what that dog listens to, but the poodle's nuts. Everybody can yell at DeSoto, but when I walk outside and I have to get hateful and go, DeSoto, get up here now! It ain't fast, but he gets there. It may take him an hour, but he'll get there. When Jesus stands up and rebukes the sea, this is not a, oh, he's so soft-spoken. It says rebuke. You see, even in the Greek here, you see the expression of the anger in the voice. And he gets up and he says, be still now. Some of you kids are like, that's exactly what my mom sounds like. And some of you are going, what does he sound like when he gets angry with his kids? I wish I could say that it's not like that, but I am a person, I'm a sinner, and I have a teenager and a preteen. Open the window a little bit. And when he says this, there's not a calming. There's not this time. It says, and it stopped. It was instant. It was something that we can't describe because we can't comprehend there being a storm and water tossing back and forth and God going, stop it! And it's stopping immediately. And that's essentially what happens because God's word is so powerful. It is so strong and it can change everything. And the saddest thing about this is that that word is so strong, is so powerful, and we have his word in our hand. And statistics tell us that most Christians spend less than 5 minutes a day reading his word, reading that kind of power, understanding how powerful this word actually is. Words that can call the dead out of the grave are the same words that tell you, I love you. I care about you. I died for you. We need to recognize when Jesus works in our life for that power that he has. And thirdly, we should have joy when Jesus calms the storms of life. Listen, when we go through those storms, when bad things happen and God brings us through it, we should rejoice in that. I can't imagine that as the sea is tossing and Jesus stands up and screams at the ocean and it stops. And I feel like Jesus in this situation really had like that dad moment when dad gets up and he's like, I said, stop it. I'm going back to my cushion to lay down. I think Jesus went right back to sleep because I think the disciples, and listen, so it says there were other boats, and I know we always put the disciples on the same boat. I kind of feel like that there were disciples on each boat, and this conversation probably took place across them. What happened? Jesus said, stop it, and it stopped. What's he doing now? Sleeping. You know, somewhere Peter's in there like, I don't know what we do now. Peter's like, I'm the oldest. They're looking at me. What do I say? This is the same guy that's going to call me a sheep later. But we should be glad when Jesus brings us through the storm. Because I guarantee you, when the storm comes, the disciples are like, yes! Think about it this way. When was the last time you went to some sporting event and something good happened? So we were, I've had the privilege to help coach the middle school baseball team at Thomas Walker. And it's an interesting group of kids. So yesterday, and we haven't been able to practice much, and we've been working through just some different things, and we're getting beat pretty bad. Wish I could. We do not win this game. Small victories. We're losing 12-0 And we're at that point where if we don't score three runs, the game is over. And we have one kid get up there, and he crushed a ball. You would have thought we won the World Series. He didn't even score. He hit it. And our whole team's like, yes! Run, 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 run. Because that's what you do at baseball. There, you know, listen, I love baseball. There's not a lot of direction. Run, 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 run. Throw the ball. Swing. You know those three words? You can go to a baseball game and feel like you know everything that's going on. And so we scored three runs, and we had to go back in the field for them to score another and end the game. But, man, we were cheering, and we were screaming. We were excited. Those guys came in after that. We're high-fiving. Everybody's happy. And we lost. When was the last time that God gave us victory over something? We were thrilled about it. Man, we told everybody. It was life-changing. God healed this person of cancer. I want to tell everybody about it. But a lot of times we want to hold that in, and we don't want to tell people what God's doing in our life. You know, 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 through 18 says, rejoice always. It also says, pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances. For this is the will of God in Jesus Christ for you. The best part of our testimony is to tell other people what God's doing in our life. For those of us that sit in here and may say something like, man, I don't know how to tell anybody about Jesus. It's really kind of easy if you think about it. Tell them what God's doing in your life. Tell them the victories that you've had. And tell them the things that have gone bad that you know he's carried you through. You know, because sometimes your boat gets dinged up in that storm. You know, sometimes we get through the storm, but maybe the sail's torn. Maybe we lost a couple oars along the way. More modern, maybe the engine, the motor on the boat fell off. I heard that happen to a friend of mine. That's hilarious to me. I'm sorry. Any of y'all that are on a lake, I know it's horrible when it happens. But if you're driving your boat on a lake and the engine falls off and goes in the water, that's funny. That's funny. It's horrible to you. You need to step back and look and find out how funny that is. It happened to me when I was horrible. But even when those things happen, we can still rejoice because we know that God is taking care of us. He got us through it. He saw us onto the other side. You know, we're told in Matthew to go and make disciples. One of the easiest ways to make disciples is to build relationships with them and let them see what God's doing in your life. I told you guys when you called me as pastor, you'd get tired of hearing this quote. I think I've done pretty good. I've only said it, I think, twice so far. But Brennan Manning said this: the greatest single cause of atheism in the world today is Christians who acknowledge Jesus with their lips and walk out the door and deny him by their lifestyle. It's what an unbelieving world simply finds unbelievable. Because I think part of that lifestyle is we're scared to tell people what Jesus has done in our life. And we should shout it from the rooftops. For our action points today, I'd humbly ask, when was the last time you let Jesus calm the storms in your life? When was the last time that you knew that things were going on and you said, God, take this, it's yours? And ultimately, like I ask every week, have you ever asked Jesus to come into your heart and in your life? Have you ever come to that point where you realize, Jesus isn't even in my boat. I can't turn anything over to him because I don't know him. I don't have a relationship with him. Hey, don't leave here today without settling that. There's a couple of ways you can do that. Everybody, for the most part, has probably handed a connection card when you came in. You can simply write on that you'd like to talk to me or somebody else and drop that in our offering buckets as you're leaving. I'll follow up with you this week. I'll hang around right after service. I'd be thrilled if you want to handle that today. Maybe you don't want to talk to me, but you know somebody that knows Jesus. Go to them. Don't wait. Let them show you from God's word how God loved you so much, he sent his son to die on the cross for you. That through professing him and having a relationship with him, you can spend eternity with him. Let's nail that down today. I'm going to ask Carrie to come. And we're just going to spend, we've done this the last couple weeks, and I just like being able to have a time where we can reflect. And maybe today, there's that storm in your life, and you need to give that to God. You can do that in your seat, where you're at. That's absolutely fine. I know some people like to come and just kneel at the altar. The altars are open if that's you. We don't do this for 15 to 20 minutes unless you need it, but just take a few minutes. Spend some time in prayer. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father God, Lord, I just thank you that we could come here today to worship you. Lord, help us to trust in you, to give you those storms, Lord, so that you can calm them and get us through the other side. Lord, we love you and we need you. Since then we pray. Father, thank you so much for allowing us to come here and be in your presence today. It's your son's name we pray. Amen. At this time, I'm going to ask our associate pastor, Shane Stewart, to come up. He's going to close us in prayer. For those of you I need to apologize to our sound team. I got a little bit more animated and loud than usual. If we have to replace speakers... I'm sorry. But those of you that are visiting, thank you so much for being here today. We greatly appreciate it. Shane is going to come up and give some announcements and close us in prayer.
He said he used his mom voice there. If my mom ever sounds like that, I will never, ever go eat at her house on Sunday afternoon again. That's scary, right? All right. A couple announcements here. Graduation recognition is next Sunday. If you know someone who's graduating high school or college, and if you've not turned in that name, we need that by today. Today is the deadline, especially on that. July the 12th through the 14th is our CLF Kids Explosion. It's our version of VBS. So that is July 12th through the 14th, and we need next Sunday, following the service, if you want to work in that, we need volunteers. We need volunteers to help us out. And so they will be a short 5-minute meeting next Sunday after the service, so we can get as many people, we know how many people we got helping next Sunday, okay? And by the way, when you go out, there's people in the back with buckets. You can give your tithes and offerings on your way out. So let's close in prayer. Thank you, Lord, for once again allowing us to come to worship. Father, we love and thank you for being the Lord of our lives, Lord, even in the midst of storms. Father, we just praise you and thank you for all that you do, for getting us through the storm and always never leaving us nor ever forsaking us, Lord, like you promised, God. We thank you. We pray for your blessings upon our people as they go out. And, Lord, just help them have a great week. In Jesus' name, amen. Anybody's good.